Okay, for beams, I'm going to place beams on the level above it, is level 3. So you go to beams, you're going to have, by default, only the metal ones, or you may have other ones, depending on who used the computer before. And you just need to load the families, and where you have to go is to structural framing, okay? Concrete, and you have 3 of them, which are quite good. You have the concrete retro beam. This is pretty much going to solve most of your issues. Pan joist with legends. So this is more like a T-shape and a pan joist, okay? If you say concrete retro beam, you can do the same as if they were metallic ones. You can say on grid. And probably before that, you want to make sure that you're in the correct level and that everything is properly set, and then select on grids. Okay. Now you press Control to select all the grids and say OK. And there you have. Now this will be a two-way slab. No. Again, under your calculation, you will get the depth. So you can just change this number by very simply editing the type, duplicate, give your own number, and change in here the B. Okay. It's not the D in this case. Sorry, the H, as in height. I think that's quite straightforward, no? If it was one directional, one of these two directions would be actually non-existent, and that would be the case, no? One directional. This would be two-way slab down here. Column, you might need the cap depending on the span. Or not, and then you will have the slab directly, and then you will have, in this case it's a one direction, you have beams on both sides, and then the slab spans between the beams. Okay. Another option you might need is the idea of one direction but with a pan joist. So you can actually create here under structure a beam system and create a boundary. I'm going to do it for now the grids, but it could be a bit more specific. And this parallel system of lines measures the direction of your beam system. We'll see how that. If I say it just, let's say just this one for now, and let's say okay, let's see what happens. This is a beam system, and it just locates equally distance within the boundary you created, and you actually tax them. If you don't want the tax, you just get rid of them, for the structure would be needed. No? Now, automatically, it took the same beams I located before, because it just selects the last beam you placed. But you might also want to select them, actually, and place other types as the beam seems to them. For that, I would recommend doing it before level 3. And before saying OK, you could set a different type of beam, no? So you say OK, and there it goes, located. If you create a beam system, you can select two things. You can select the beam that forms part of that system individually, or you can just move around and step on top of the beam system, which gives you this kind of a dashed line in blue grid. If you select that, you can actually change very easily the parameters that beam system has. For example, the elevation, if you want to drag it down, like -1 feet or whatever. I'm going to go to a 3D. That was dragged down. Again, you can do it in 3D and select that, again, that kind of a blue grid there. And you can change that parameter, like 0, and it will move the whole thing up. You have fixed distance, but you can also have different variations as in how you want to place your beam system. You can say a fixed number instead of fixed system, and within the boundary, you will create exactly the number of beams you need. You have other, like maximum spacing or clear spacing, etc. And these are, again, you can set this to 12, and it will just create double the number, no? That would be... Again, this would be one direction, main beams, and beam system between them. So that would be actually one direction. Okay. see if I can select this guy now. Sometimes you have to go to the plan to select the beam system. Okay, you can actually load more structures. You can always just go to the beam and load here under load family and search for other framing, like structural framing, concrete. And you, let's just select both of them, why not, and load them. So now they're there. Now I can select the beam system and just change them. Actually, I can just edit the type, edit the type, and well, now I can select each of the beams and just locate there the different loaded options. So I can say, you know, give me the pan joist there. But obviously there should be a way to, here is the beam type. This allows you to change all of the beam systems at the same time, no? And it will search for all the options you have loaded. So let's say, analyze, there you go. You go to the 3D. And if you don't see them again, it's because that offset condition. So if you go and change the offset, you could just select the beam size, beam system, and set this to -1 feet, which is actually the dimension of the slab, no? And there they are. They're a bit kind of a ridiculous in size, so I'm going to change their beam type to be a little bit bigger. Okay. Now that one is floating probably because it's actually a bit larger. Let's say -6 inches actually. There you go. So again, if you go to the structural plans, this will start looking like this. No, so you have, this is a one-way when you have main girders from column to column, and then secondary pans going from girder to girder, okay? Good. What if we want a T-flange? And I'm going to delete this beam system. Well, if you want to create your own T-flange, I mean T-shaped flange, you can just say new family, and this will be the same way as creating your own beam. If you want to create your own, you just go down to structural framing, beam and braces, and you say open. And again, this is going to sound very familiar, very similar to doing your own columns. Okay, so we have a series of default settings. Actually, the default setting is a beam. Okay, and under elevations, you can see how the beam is laid out. No? So what we want is a very simple kind of a reduction of what a T-flange looks like. So we need to create a series of like reference planes, as always. Okay. I'm going to copy this reference plane. I'm going to put a dimension. And I'm going to create another set of reference planes without really looking too much, because what we're going to do is dimension them, DI, and make sure that they're equal, so that solves the problem. And then another DI to measure the whole thing, so we have several parameters. Okay, you can set the parameters and call them, this would be horizontal dimension. Okay, and this would be vertical dimensional. Okay, now it's, instead of doing the extrusion from the top view, in this case I'm going to do it from the elevation. So I'm going to just go create an extrusion. Actually, I can just pick a name of elevation here. Left, for example. And I can create a rectangle. Start locking it properly, and then and say, okay, and if we go to the 3D, it's like far away, we could just go to the top view and start dragging this to the proper dimensions. So you can use the AL alignment and then lock, alignment, and then lock. Okay. So in a way, this will start moving with it properly. You can also go to the parameters, start seeing that you can change these elements. No? Now, the default here is because there's actually one parameter included by default, so that's the one you're using. And again, as always, save. We will, you know, name it, let's call it T-flange, and load into the project. And now we can deal with it as if it was another beam, no? For example, we can say beam, and there's our T-flange, and we can just say from where to where very easily, no? If you had grids, but this one will be between beams, for example. Select between beams. You always make sure that it's level where you want it. 3D. In this case, also has like an offset, so just remember that if you want to locate it underneath, you just have to set the offsets properly. Minus one. Control C. Oh, here it is. I was looking at the other side, sorry. Control C, Control V, apply, and there you go. Okay. You can copy these ones from the top view. You can also drag them slightly, so it's quite useful. You can use them as, if you know exactly the dimension, let's go. You can use them as a, let's go back very fast, as a beam system. So you just go to the top view, for example, and you start creating a beam system. No? You drag the boundary of the beam system. Okay, you can even just offset this to move it exactly to the border of the girder. And here you make sure you set the distance properly, as in what is the distance of our T-flange. So I'm just going to say okay for now. And obviously they're not going to correspond, because we need to know that dimension. No? So if I select one and I say edit the type, I can see that the H dimension, which is the one, is 4 feet 2 inches. So you could change that parameter. Obviously you have different types of T-flange. So you could actually select the beam system and change the fixed distance to 4 feet 6 inches, I think it was, huh? Let's go to the 3D. Select the beam system again and offset it down minus 1 feet. There you go. This would be a beam system done with T-flange, okay? And again, remember T-flange allows you to, it's a precast element, so you will assign a material precast. And what you can do is actually very simply calculate that span that the T-flange allows you to have, like up to even 40 feet or so. It's a very, it really solves large spans if you need that type of option. Okay, I'm going to stop it there.